Hey guys, Nick60 here, coming to you with an unexpected Star Citizen video. They just released a new, vessel for pre-release sale, the Carrack, which I will go into more detail in, but it looks like it has come out alongside, well, a new online game. And I have no idea what this is. I literally just clicked it and hit record, and so let's have a look, shall we? Okay. Okay, so I'm here, I guess. Maybe? Scroll to continue. Alert, system scan alert. The Britannia drops out of interspace into the Null system. Your helpful Galactopedia system info indicates that you are officially outside of UEE territory. The Null system consists of 5 planets with 2 known landing zones. The Galactopedia advises caution, as this is a known pirate system. Okay, so... sweet! This is basically like a revamp of the old text-based adventure games. This is gonna be fun. Okay, so let's have a look at our options. Oh, I should have explained it a little bit better. The Carrack is an exploration ship, which is why stuff goes this way. So, we have... stay low and scan. Respecting the potential danger, you keep your signature low in order to do a full sweep of the system without attracting any attention. COSA plots a course around any landing zones to minimize the chance of running into someone or ask around. Yeah, could tell COSA to set a course for the Olympus settlement on Null 5. De Arana, I think that's pronounced right, pulls you away from the others. You sure about this? That place can be a little rough. You recite the famous quote from the explorer Nossa Fon. Never spend hours learning what the locals can tell you in 5 minutes. Having said that, I'm gonna stay low and scan. Britannia reaches the system for searches the system for hours. Unfortunately, the course setting was too cautious, of course, preventing your dedicated scanning array from obtaining optimal data. After all that searching, you have a little more information. You have little more information than you started. Okay, so we lost some fuel. Integrity morale is still the same. Guess we're gonna continue scrolling. Ooh, known specifications. Propulsion. Size 6 propulsion. Factory power plant coming soon. Max engine 2. Factory engine coming soon. Maneuvering thruster 16. Big ship. Factory maneuvering thrusters coming soon. Max shield 7. Shield coming soon. And I did see that it had 4 gun turrets, so it's not exactly gonna be helpless. Scrolling, come along. Alert, moon, alert. Potential cosmic anomaly brings you near the second moon of Null 2, but when it turns out to be just typical dust cloud, Taurus suggests the data on the spectrum for the moon is a little light. While we're here, it might be a good idea to do a closer pass near the surface and see if we turn up anything interesting. Trust in your crew's instincts, you instruct COSA to bring the Britannia close. Which side, sir, light or dark? You think back to your first time exploring the dark side of moon and shudder. No thank you. Pushing that memory aside, you instruct, take us to the light side, COSA. Everyone knows you find the best stuff on the light side. No, I don't think so. Dark side tends to see less traffic, which could mean less to find, but it could also mean more left for you to discover. With your best captain's voice, you say, bring us to the dark side. I'm never going to do that again. COSA takes the ship in while Taurus gets to work. Say the dark horizon until the data begins to trickle into your console. COSA changes the their course after picking up some volcanic plumes in the distance. Kosa, hold up, Taurus quickly blurts out. Kosa slows the ship down and circles back. What is it, you ask, while staring quizzically at your terminal. Here, Taurus says, and highlights a point in the scan map. You get closer to discover a series of old escape pods. Closer examination reveals them to be from a long-last Empire naval ship. Maybe it's somewhere in the area. Regardless, you make a note of the location and flag it to send to the Navy when you get back to UEE space. Yay! I should have landed on the planet. Yep, I was right. Two guns each side. Arguments, hoy. Let's see what else there is, shall we? So we're in day 11. Ooh. Okay, alert. Meteors alert. Well, I could have seen that from the visual clues, but okay. Taurus hails you excited. Captain, scans are lighting up an uncharted meteorite field off the starboard. Meteoroid, sorry. Judging from its spread and direction, my guess is it's got a pretty big orbital path. It might not be in the area for a long time. Search the field or scan the area. Not wanting to miss a rare opportunity, you're confident in your Carrack's ability to weather the meteoroid field. You ask Kosa to bring you in closer, or knowing the kind of havoc an unexpected meteoroid field can wreck, you instruct Taurus to see if anything will be caught in its path. Let's have a look at the field. No! I don't like red stuff. As you draw near, the truth becomes clear. This isn't a meteoroid field at all. Your crew stands silently together as they stare through the Carrack's large canopy at the remnants of a destroyed mining ship hurtling through space. What Taurus has mistaken as meteoroids are in reality the vessel's mined cargo spilling out of its shattered hull. The Arana ponders out loud. Why would someone blow up a mining vessel if they weren't even trying to rob it? You order the crew to be on alert as the debris shrinks from view. Well, I can understand the morale hit from that, I suppose. And maybe it will bring up a safer answer further along because we're on alert. Day 15 so far? Day 16 so far. Additional equipment. This is a big ship. Anvil Carrack comes fully equipped with a medical and repair bay, a map room, and a sensor suite. A Tarsus Tunneler jump engine and a dedicated computer core for jump charting. The ship carries 3 docking collars, a launcher for unmanned explorer drone pods, a small manned launch, and, as in, mini ship, and a rover for ground operations. Big ship. Probably one of the biggest we've had, except, of course, for the Javelin. By the way, I should point this out at some point in the video. It's currently available preview sale, lifetime insurance for $350. So, it's a biggie. Nothing. Just gonna keep scrolling. So, that looks interesting. Here we go. Alert. Rival explorers. Alert. Go away. I will fix you later. You don't need to go away. Chow time. The Arana is on the bridge while the rest of the crew grabs some food. Gutierrez is in the middle of a story about a particularly raucous trip to Goss when the ship suddenly reverberates with the unmistakable hum of shields absorbing a shot. Everyone breaks for the bridge. You arrive to see a ship streak past the canopy. A face comes over General Comms. This is our scrap of nowhere. Go find your own. It's another exploration vessel named Rip and Rag. They roll their ship to bring their weapons to bear. Your crew looks at you expectantly. It'd be nice to know what kind of ship, so I knew if we could take them or not. And can confront them, perfectly confident in the Carrack's offensive and defensive capabilities, so if it comes to a fight, you're more than willing to step up. You get the feeling that these jokers are flashing their guns more than anything, and if you back down, you only incite them more. You decide to show them who they're screwing with. Or, stay diplomatic. No one needs to die here. If they wanted to kill you, they wouldn't have stopped firing, so there's obviously a diplomatic resolution to this. Let's take the Captain Picard approach this time. You open the comm to the rippin' rag captain. Look, I can see you're armed. You probably can guess what this baby's pecking. Now, we could bash each other until one of us cracks, but I'll be honest. I'd really rather not waste our time. What are you out here looking for? The captain stares at you, slightly befuddled. Or he manages to stammer out. Fair enough, we're looking for a jump, so we're not competition, which means there's no need for Okay. Captain's quiet for a moment. He glances at someone off visual for help. Clearly, he's not quite sure how to handle this situation, so he cuts off communication and flies away. Well, I got my morale back, though we're gonna need to do something about the fuel. Empty space. Ooh, music's getting ominous. I just realized that these are the names of other people who have played this. Yeah, I'm running out of fuel too. I'm not liking these. I'm not liking what's happened to these guys. The skiff and the rover. The Carrack isn't just one ship, it's three! In addition to the base ship and drones, you also get a Pisces-class launch, designed and redacted, and an Ursa-class rover for ground exploration. Imagine discovering a derelict alien ship deep in the unknown and then dispatching a crewman in the launch for a closer view. Or discovering a strange new world and then setting down with the Ursa to see what's over the horizon. So, this ship's gonna be competing with the exploration variant of the constellation, Little Connie. I'm sorry. I'm so ashamed of myself. Okay, we're starting to run out of return fuel. I'm not liking all these vanished, says... I'm not liking all the vanished is disappeared is people gone. My crew's morale seems to be doing well, but I'm not liking this. Music isn't helping. Alert, jump point scan alert. A cup of tea warms your hand as you sit in the bridge gazing out of the Carrack's wraparound canopy. The endless expanse of space enveloping you causes your mind to wander. What would it be like to discover a new system? Would it be self-centered to name it after yourself? What if you made first contact? That would be cool. They could name a whole alien race after you. Good luck with that. You really need to write a comm back to your cousin. Should you lend him the credits he's asking for? Your mother says New Austin doesn't really need another foo-foo restaurant. Captain, I'm picking up a signal. Taurus's voice snaps at you out of your reverie. It's weak, but I think it might be a jump. You focus your display onto the most recent scan info, and sure enough, a faint glimmer is highlighted. Now, do we enter the jump point? This is what you have been waiting for. With a quick nod to Kosa, you tell everyone to strap in. Gutierrez shifts all power to the shields in the jump drive, while the Britannia makes a beeline for the potential discovery of your life. You never heard about entire crews being killed due to a severe case of caution. With a swallow, you temporarily bury your excitement about the possible find and have Diarana launch a probe to gather some more info. I'm not liking all the vanishes, but if I have to play the role of explorer, I've decided I'm going to be an explorer. You grit your teeth as you approach the potential jump, readying for the flip your stomach does every time you breach interspace, when suddenly Torres alerts you that the signal is moving. You turn sharply. A moving jump point? Nirana cuts in. I don't think it's a jump, sir. The readings we're getting, if I didn't know better, I'd say they were sentient made. As if on cue, the signal moves away from your ship at such speed that even the Carrack's powerful engines have a hard time keeping up. Kosak turns to you with a stunned grin. Well, Captain, you did promise we'd see some exciting things if we flew with you. Whatever the heck that thing was doesn't qualify. So we lost some fuel, but we did get morale, okay? I need fuel! Please! Fuel! At least I didn't vanish! Fuel? Day 35. There's nothing out here, and the music is getting a little bit more ominous now. Okay. Good news is I haven't lost the hull yet. Ooh. We got a new one. The canopy. Battle between visibility and protection is always difficult for an exploration ship. Do you see the distant stars you're exploring and put yourself at risk of alien attack, meteor strike, or worse? Or do you chart the galaxy in an armored box? Anvil has solved that problem with the Carrack, which features a beautiful single-pane multi-story cockpit window that offers an unprecedented view of the unknown, alongside a titanium-reinforced blast cover capable of sealing off the ship quickly when danger strikes. When in blast mode, the Carrack relies on its extensive onboard sensors for flight. Ooh, it is a big ship. Continuing to scroll. Here we go. Ah, oh, great, banished slavers. Frantic call from the Koso wakes you in your bunk. Get up here, we got contact. You race to the bridge to see a Banu merchantman dead ahead. Have they hailed us, you ask. Taurus looks back at you, says they haven't stopped, and flips the comms onto the speakers. Travel, friend, and shall be quite agreeable in the meantime of items and wares that might be desired or considered. The Banu captain starts introducing his wares. You glare at Kosa, who bursts out laughing. I thought you might like the shop. You look back to the comm screen to see the Banu present his next products. The crew of the Rip and Rag, the rival explorers from earlier, now enslaved. Kosa stops laughing. We have indignation. Without missing a beat, you demand that the Banu release the slaves, or amusement. Normally you're against slavery of all kind. Thanks to the treatment the Rip and Rag crew gave you, you're willing to look the other way this time. I think we're gonna let these guys have it. Indignation. The Banu captain is shocked and apologizes profusely for offending you. He shuffles the Rip and Rag crew off visual while assuring you that these workers are bound to a traditional Banu servitude contract and will be able to purchase their freedom once their asset value is paid off. He continues talking for 2 uninterrupted hours until you can't take it anymore and buy the slaves off of them. The captain ends up throwing in a few trinkets as well, then flies off. The Rip and Rag, thank you, apologizing for the behavior and the incident earlier. Yeah, I'm a sucker for this, and I'm also pretty anti-slavery, so. Moving on. I'm gonna run out of fuel. Day 41. Rip and Rag people didn't give us fuel. Day 43. Day 45. I don't like these hull failures. Losing morale again. Hull integrity is still at 100%. So it's a tough bird. DA-47. Alert Nebula. The Britannia slowly approaches a beautiful prismatic nebula. The dense fog of particles scramble your scans, making it impossible to see what's inside. You glance at Kosu, who shrugs. No risk, no reward, I guess. Yeah, unless we crash into an asteroid, Torres replies sardonically. This is true, Kosa responds and turns to you. What's the call? Enter the nebula or chart around it? You know what? Let's go in. All ahead full. Pushing through the nebula, it's not as dense once you're on the inside, allowing the scans to provide some navigational help. You don't find anything of interest until Gutierrez comes up to the bridge. Thought I'd give you a heads up. The scoops can use whatever this nebula is made of as a fuel source, so take your time. Fuel 10. Yes! I'm not liking what some of these are. And I'm still gonna run out of fuel at this rate. Also, I seem to be experiencing lag in a browser. Fuel empty, fuel empty. Fuel empty. Fuel empty. Can I rescue these guys? Do I just run out of fuel and that's the end of the game and I become another little red dot? I have no idea. Okay, alert crew problems. Are you seriously eating the last Bok me, I don't even know how to pronounce that. You know I brought those. With a deep sigh, you tell Kosa to take the helm as you head down to the racks to see what the heck the matter is this time. Holding a steaming bowl of noodles, Deirana innocently grins at Gutierrez. We share everything in the galley. Ain't that right, Captain? That Bok me is mine, Deirana. I swear you take one more bite and the next thing you'll be eating is my fist, snarls Gutierrez. Locking eyes, the grin drops away from Deirana's face as they raise a chopstick pinch of noodles towards their mouth. Either we let them sort it out, or we intervene. I'm gonna intervene. Crap. Enough, you harshly exclaim, freezing both crew members into place. Give the... You two have to start, but before you can really dig into electron sharing, a sudden impact hurls you sideways, shattering the bowl in the process. As quickly as the three of you can gain your feet, you rush to the bridge where Kosa sheepishly sits at the helm. Sorry about that, Captain. I may have fallen asleep for a moment. Seriously, I only shut my eyes for like a second and, well, we may have run into an asteroid. Really? With a heavy sigh, you realize that your control of the Britannia may have already slipped from your grasp. Crap! I should have just let him have it. Integrity minus 25, morale minus 5. Okay. There's so many fuel empties that doesn't make me comfortable. The bridge. Carrack's bridge is one of the most advanced in the galaxy, featuring control surfaces for extensive scanning, mapping, and charting sensor suites. Multiple seats with their own dedicated actions give a crew of six plenty to do, whether you're traveling through deep space or approaching an unexplored world. Originally deployed as a military mapping ship, the Carrack has an entire computer core dedicated to charting and transiting jump points. Combined with the high tensile hull armor, the Carrack is one of the safest ships in the galaxy for striking out into the unknown. I kind of like this. They ought to do stuff like this more with new ships as they release them. But holy crap, this is a long one. And I'm gonna run out of fuel soon. Day 66. Oh, those look like Vanduul. Yep, shields light up with two impacts in quick succession before you even have time to react. We've been hit, rerouting energy to forward shields. They are on a quickly calls quickly from her terminal. You fire off orders. Torres, give me something. Kosa, start putting on speed. Gutierrez, we're going to be burning hot. Get ready. Torres relays the information as rapidly as it appears on the screen. Three contacts. Vanduul, it's a hunting party, sir. Well, crap. There's a reason you brought a Carrack over the other exploration ships on the market. And let's just say it wasn't for its reinforced fuel tanks. As you head to the twin turrets, you toss instructions over your shoulder. Kosa, keep us moving, but give us time to line our shots. Torres, chafe and flare as you chafe and flare are your new best friends. They run at you with me. Or hide. Though the Carrack is fully capable of handling itself in a fight, you're not some teen looking to blade. No reason to test your crew against three Scythe if there's another way out. Kosa, set course for that ionic discharge cloud Torres picked up a few minutes ago. Deirana growls in disbelief. We're running. Torres corrects him. No, we're hiding. You calm down the Katiras. As soon as we hit that cloud, make our SIG disappear. I'm going to be honest. Three Scythes. Let's blow them out of the sky. There are a lot of thingies up there. You try to fight them off, but it was not looking good as the Vanduuls circle around you. Incoming Torres warns as three missiles, one from each side, scream towards the Britannia. Fire and chafe. You stare at the approaching missile with an idea strikes you. Wait, Torres, what kind of missile is it? You hold your breath while Torres scans the approaching payloads. Dumbfire, sir. This might just work. Forget the chafe, Kosa. When I say drop, spin us straight down. Drop. Carrack gracefully dips out of the line of fire as the missiles continue on the course right past where your ship was and into the unexpected Vanduul on the other side. No way, Deirana says in disbelief as the fiery explosions dissipate. To be honest, you didn't really expect that to work either. But it's cool, and it only cost us 5 fuel, 20 integrity, and we got morale. Unfortunately, lots of little red things, almost out of fuel. Day 67. This is gonna be over soon. Should have just landed. Holy crap, lag. In a browser game. I'm gonna run out of fuel. Day 74. I'm gonna run out of fuel. Lots of signatures. Lack of morale, fuel empty, lack of morale, lack of morale, lack of morale. Fuel empty, fuel empty, fuel empty. Not comforting. Holy crap. What's with all the lines? This is it. Morale and fuel dwindling. Soon we shall have a game over. Day 80. People hate me. Ship's doing relatively okay, almost out of fuel. Day 81. Fuel's gone. Fuel empty. Your hydrogen scoop scavenges enough to get you moving, but it's a snail's pace. Certainly not fast enough to get you anywhere before your supplies run out. You set your beacon and hope for the best. Days stretch into weeks with no response. Everyone's on quarter rations, but the crew's on a razor edge. Then, one day, salvation. A ship approaches. It's the Banu merchantman from earlier. The captain is more than happy to sell you some fuel, but unfortunately you have nothing of value to him. Undeterred, he presents you with a standard boilerplate Banu servitude contract for one of your crew. That should cover some fuel. He'll even throw in a few scrubbers, too. Faced with the prospect of being stuck out here forever, you look over your crew. Are you kidding me? I should have blown this guy to pieces. I paid him. And that's that. Anvil Carrack, temporarily available for its preview sale for $350 lifetime insurance. Gonna have a look at that in a second. Technical overview, lots of stuff being fleshed out. It's a big ship, that's for sure. Comes with Carrack lifetime insurance. In-game poster, in-game model, and the Reveille New York luxury hangar. So, yeah, that is the Carrack and its introductory game. Head on over to robertspaceindustries.com to have a look. Certainly very interesting. I may try that again with some different choices. But for now, this is Nick60 signing off. If you liked what you saw... oh, jeez. And want to see more, please check out my channel. Feel free to subscribe, or if you want to keep up to date, my Twitter would be a good place, Nick60Vids. If you liked what you saw and are feeling really generous, I have a Patreon, nudge nudge, wink wink, Nikolai60, links in the description. So yeah, this has been Star Citizen Anvil Carrack, and I will see you guys next time. Nick60 signing off.